Yeah, yeah. So whenever you say, I'll start.
Yeah.
But I can't see your pictures.
That is not required.
Okay, then it's fine.
Yeah, you can start now. Thanks, Harsha, for the advice.
Pardon me?
Yeah, you can start now.
Okay. Good morning, Radha. Good morning, all visitors to this forum. We'll discuss the basics of sleeve gastrectomy. We all know that sleeve gastrectomy is the most popular bariatric surgery now. And at present, more than 60% of the bariatric surgical procedures are sleeve gastrectomy. Historically, we know that vertical banded gastroplasty was the one which started long time ago, where one circular stapler was used somewhere high up. From there, another stapler was used. You created a narrow, small port and prevent it from dilating the band of. This was technically very difficult in many people during times of open surgery. So this led to another. This hole was made lower down near the antrum, which is very easy to reach, and from there, long. So this is referred to as megastoma nil operation. Nil referring to the antrum. So once people knew that it is relatively easy to make a sleeve, then they decided that we. When Scopinaro brought in his BPD, initially, as I mentioned yesterday, he did a distal gastrectomy. Subsequently, it was changed into a sleeve gastrectomy. So the sleeve of those days was the first stage of a complex bariatric procedure to give time for the patient to recover. But over a period of time, many patients dropped enough weight to make sleeve gastrectomy a standalone procedure. The only difference is the sleeve which is used now is a much tighter sleeve compared to the previous sleeves. What are the indications? So basically, most cases which are coming up for bariatric surgery would qualify for sleeve gastrectomy. The international guidelines are BMI more than 40 without any disease and more than 35 with one or more comorbidities. For India and other Asia-Pacific conditions, the indications are BMI more than 35 anyway, or when there are comorbidities, BMI more than 30. Sleeve gastrectomy is preferable in young people, because there is no malabsorption and the long-term complications of malabsorption are avoided. It is also preferred in people who are suspected to have or found to have an actual child's cirrhosis at the time of surgery, because you do not want to create any malabsorption which may cause significant liver failure. Also, if you have patients who are on long-term medications for multiple diseases like renal, post-renal transplantation or rheumatoid arthritis or psychiatric medicines, wherein you are a little concerned about absorption of the medication, if you do a bypass, then you do a sleeve gastrectomy. There are people whom you may come across once in a while who do not want to wish to take supplements for whatever reason. So in which case, if they qualify otherwise, you can offer them sleeve gastrectomy. A word of caution, most people would like to recommend that sleeve is not a procedure of choice for people who are deducted to have a GERD or hiatus hernia during your workup. One of the reasons is sleeve being a high pressure system tends to exacerbate GERD, and sometimes the hiatus hernia also can become larger over a period of time, which makes reflex disease more problem. However, the opinion is not uniformly accepted. There are a large number of patients who respond in their GERD after doing a sleeve gastrectomy. It is ideally not suited for people who are sweet eaters, because here you do only a restriction, and if they take high calorie thing, the benefit of bariatric surgery may not be adequate. Sleeve is not particularly a very good procedure for people who are super obese, BMI more than 50, unless you are considering it as a first stage procedure, and you can consider some other procedure as a second stage. Pre-op assessment is like any other bariatric surgery. You need to assess their mobility so that you know whether they'll be able to follow up their physical activities. Psychologically, you should know whether they are acceptable to your suggestions, whether they are likely to carry on instructions given. People who are smoking and alcohol should not be generally taken for bariatric surgery, because both of them are inimical to the patient after surgery. Patients, especially who are on psychiatric medications and other chronic medication, need to be assessed by their own physician whether bariatric surgery is applicable to them, and they will follow with the medications. It is imperative that we look and optimize coexisting diseases such as hypothyroidism and other diseases, which you all know. An important aspect of bariatric surgery is you will have to look for comorbid conditions like hypertension, diabetes, etc., etc. Especially if they have a fatty liver or if there is evidence of NASH, you need to look into them and have the gastroenterologist, hepatologist to evaluate. It is not uncommon to find patients with patients coming up for bariatric surgery with massive obesity who have pre-existing nutritional deficiencies. It very commonly you see iron deficiency, calcium and vitamin deficiency also are very common in them. So it needs to be looked into and treated. It's very good to have all these patients routed through pulmonology and cardiology department so that if they have OSA and other problems, it can be looked into. Upper GI endoscopy is a must so that you are well prepared in case there is a surprise, and you are also well prepared if there is a GERD or hiatus hernia, etc. Ultrasound is required to assess the status of the liver, and also you'll have to see whether you have a gallbladder stone, in which case you may consider doing a cholecystectomy along with the procedure. It is exceedingly important when the patient is being prepared for surgery that there is some psychological counseling, and you make sure that the patient is actually committed to coming for surgery, because surgery is not the end of the whole thing. It is just a beginning and it is just a tool. The patient will have to follow your nutritional advice, physical activities and other things. All diseases need to be optimized, and unless the patient is fully optimized, you should not take the patient for bariatric surgery. These patients need to have reduction in the liver size because of the fatty liver, and the only way you can achieve it quickly is by reducing the carbohydrate intake. So very low calorie diet, and if preferable, you put the patient on liquid diet if you can take, and for at least 1 to 2 weeks is necessary. And if the patient is losing some weight during this process, that means he is following your dietary advice well, and it also shows the possibility of liver reducing in size is very good. It's imperative that these patients need to do incentive spirometry so that the lung condition is good and they do not develop post-op lung problems. Many of these OSA patients may be on CPAP or even BiPAP if they are OHS, and they need to be put on these medications. Apart from, they need to be on CPAP as advised by the pulmonologist. It's necessary, of course, to have a DVT profile access. I don't have to go into the details. I'm sure most of you know you need a special OT table for these people who may be 200 kg plus. You should have a nice option to have very good head elevation, leg spreading, etc., etc. We need a bougie, anything between 32 to 40 size if you want to do a sleeve gastrectomy. Most of us have the gastric calibration tube made by Johnson & Johnson, which is about 37, 38 French. Occasionally, you may need long trocars and long instruments to reach high up in the GE junction. And you need long flexible staplers with various thickness staples for your procedure. We will need a 13 millimeter ports routinely. Occasionally, if you are going to use a black cartridge or something, we need a 15mm. A person should have a liver retractor, something like Nathanson or something else, which will be useful at the time of surgery. The standard position is legs apart, but many surgeons tend to stand on the right side only. So it is optional. It's a question of getting used to. You can do the surgery from the right or from between the legs, and port positions in them will vary. A nasogastric tube should be introduced first so that the stomach can be emptied. Otherwise, it's a big mess. There are many people who may consider putting a bougie at the first stage, because as you can see from this picture, when a patient is put into position, his head comes so low down, the anesthetist finds it to intubate. I mean, after intubation, to put the bougie later. So some of these people may like to put the bougie in the beginning itself. Port positions are highly variable. Basically, you need a camera port which will be at or well above the umbilicus. And you need two ports for the surgeon, one of which may be a 12-13 mm port for the stapler. It can be on the left side, it can be on the right side, it's up to you. You need one port for the liver retractor and one or two ports for assistants to help you during surgery. So the configurations are variable depending upon whether you are going to stand between the legs or stand on the right side or even on the left side. Initial entry is variable. As most of you know, you can use a Veriscan needle at the camera port or at Palmar point, or you can use a VisiPort, OptiPort straight away, or you can inflate CO2 and then do that. Occasionally, you may have to do an open cannula technique, especially if the patient has had any abdominal surgeries in the past. One thing to remember is these people have an exceedingly thick anterior abdominal wall. So your ports are very difficult to be placed. And if you put vertical, it is easy for you to manipulate better. But then you remember, when you have such a thick anterior abdominal wall fat, if you put obliquely, you may be able to reach target, but it is very difficult to move. So torque is a major problem in these patients. If you are going to put the ports obliquely, your ability to move left, right, up and down is very low, and you may run out of length of the trochas. So it is common for people to find the lateral ports placed on the extreme left is usually inadequate, keeps coming out because the length is inadequate. All of you know sleeve dissection. Basically, you will have to disconnect the greater omentum from the greater curvature, and you should run between the vascular arcade and the stomach. You start it somewhere near the mid antrum. Sometimes you may go up to the pylorus and up to the G junction. Lift off the fundus. One of the essential things is the fundus will have to be fully lifted off from the retroperitoneum and from the left crest. Retained fundus is one of the major causes for failure of this procedure. However, you need to be very careful when you are very close to the spleen and splenic artery, because you have very short gastric vessels and injury or splenic artery can at times happen. You will have to be very careful to produce no thermal injury to the fundus or deep junction. Also, you will have to be careful when you are coming near the pylorus, because the gastric epiphytic vessels may get torn if you are not very careful. Retrogastric additions will have to be cleared so that you can lift up the stomach very nicely and you can make a very tight sleeve. Most people will recommend that when you go to the GE junction, lift it off the left crest, but don't dissect the GE junction fat, because it is a kind of marker for you to go to the left of the fat so that you have not taken the G junction. If the fat is too much, you may have to do. So this is just to show the initial. The initial starting is somewhere well beyond the antrum towards the mid body. So that is the place where the thick omentum, which is on the right side, becomes thinner as it is on the left side. So you just have a look, ensure you can use your harmonic any which way, it doesn't make much difference because there is hardly anything which you can injure. So just go between very close to the wall. Even if you make injury, if there is an injury to the stomach wall, it's not an issue because it's going to be resected. So the moment you see that you have opened it, so you extend it. So continue your dissection fully. So you go on all through. So once you're dissected, so I'm not giving any more videos, but once you're dissected full length, you'll have to be careful to have the bougie placed. If the bougie has not been placed earlier, you can have it placed now. There are many views about the bougie. There are many people who place the bougie straight away into the antrum. There are many people who don't put the bougie inside. So it depends on where you start. Your initial transection can be anywhere between 2 to 7 centimeters or even 10 centimeters from the pylorus. Most people tend to be around 4 to 5 centimeters from the pylorus. There is a very nice way to assess where the antrum is, where the body is. T till you reach antrum, the vessels are running from lesser cow to greater cow. But once you go to the antrum, the vessels are running horizontally, that is along the length of antrum. So you will have to make a decision as to how far you will have to dissect the omentum. So this is first firing. So you can place it as close to the pylorus. My practice is generally between 2 to 3 centimeters from the pylorus. Sometimes I go very close. And it is important to know the first firing, you will have to stay away from the bougie. You will have to have about 1 centimeter at least from the bougie. The reason is that is where the incisora comes. Where the incisora comes, it should not be narrow. That is one of the reasons why people have difficulty in eating, and one of the complications of the surgery is leak, which occurs when there is an obstruction. It is necessary for you to remove any crotch staple which may interfere with the second one. So once you're done, so you can place the second stapler, so which is also slightly away from the bougie, and you can have your assistant to pull it from the lateral edge of the greater curvature. So from after this, you come very close to the bougie and take it out fully. See, they make sure that at the there is enough space between the bougie and your staple line when you are very close to the incisora. So this picture shows you there are three areas where you need to be careful. One is, like which I mentioned, near the pylorus, you have the gastro vessels here. So you have to be very careful here. Your decision to cut maybe anything from 2 centimeters to 7 centimeters, and this is the incisora. This area may cause a problem if you make it very tight. And so here, as I showed in the previous videos, you make it wider, far away from the bougie. This is the GE junction. You have to be very careful that you don't go very close. One of the reasons why people have leak is the staple end goes on to the GE junction and on to the esophagus. So best is to make a line not like this, but away. So this is called dog earing. So you leave about 1 centimeter from the GE junction, and one of the best ways to ensure that you leave this area free is to have the fat totally attached to the GE junction, as I mentioned earlier. The second thing is, as I showed earlier, when you come to the incisora, move your staple line away so that this area is wider. And this is what I mentioned. You can be from 2 centimeter to about 7 or 8 centimeters. So it depends upon where you go. But whatever you do, make sure this area, which is at the incisora, is wider. So this is to show you. As I mentioned earlier, you have a dog ear, so leave. So you can see very little of the fat is here. Most of the fat will be here. So you ensure that there is a dog ear one. Second is, you move your staple line away so that this area is wider, there is no obstruction. And you will have to place your staples in such a way that there is no twisting, as you can see here. This is a specimen which is taken out. All these points are at, and there is a uniform placement of the suture line. After you have done this resection, you will have to ensure that there is no suture line bleeding. If you find a small ooze, you can use clip, you can use bipolar, or you can even suture that. You will have to ensure, as I mentioned repeatedly, there is no narrowing or twisting of the gastric tube, which often occurs near the incisora. That is where the stomach curves. You also will have to ensure there is no bleeding from the short gastric or near the GE junction which you have dissected. There are some people who use buttresses for staples, but that is an optional thing and it makes the cost much more than the cost of staples itself. Most people believe that it is necessary to do a overrunning suturing of the staple line, and many people also put the omentum. You can do it for the entire suture staple line, or you can do it only for the proximal, because more than 90% of the leaks, when they occur near the GE junction, which is the most vulnerable area. So that area is always sutured and omentum is placed for the staple line. At the end of the procedure, you must do your leak test. which can be with methylene blue injected through the gastric tube, or it can be air and you fill in the abdominal cavity with the saline, so you will know. So leak test is very useful, though some people may not like to do. I personally think it is an excellent test to show that your suture line is good, and it will also help you in case there is a leak in medical legal aspects. Placing a drain is optional, so if you think there is a need, you can put, otherwise it's up to you. Post-op, you give instructions that the patient should be mobilized early. The patient is given TE prophylaxis. Incentives parameter is to be continued. I tend to do a check protocol CT with oral gastrography in the next morning. There are some people who do it second day. Some people don't do it at all. So depending upon your school of thought, you can start the patient on liquids either from the post-op evening or POD1. My policy is to do a check protocol in the morning. After that, start the patient on liquids. Usually the patient can be discharged on second or third post-op day, depending upon the patient's convenience. However, a word of caution here. If you have a patient who has OSA, either detected pre or detected and after surgery, these patients need the long period of observation, because these people go into complications with hypoxemia, leading to even arrest at times over next days. It usually happens between day 3 to day 7. So many of these patients with OSA is to be observed in the hospital until the patient is used to CPAP or BiPAP, which they are confident of continuing on their own at home. But my suggestion is patients who are not been detected to have OSA earlier should be kept in the hospital. The discharge advice is usual. You tell them to be on liquids, which over about 10 days to 14 days can make it into a thicker liquid. After that, pureed, then mashed food, and they can get back to a normal diet in 4 to 6 weeks. My policy is that it should be 2 weeks, and they get into normal diet after 6 weeks. High protein, low calorie diet is what is to be advised. These patients should be told the eating etiquette, which is as soon as they feel full, they should stop eating, number one. Number two, they should not drink liquids when they are eating. And they should have high protein diet, otherwise there is a good chance that these people may go into hypoproteinemia. Multivitamin supplements are necessary for all patients who undergo any bariatric surgery. Some of these patients may also need injection B12 1000 microgram every month, unless of course the patient can be tested periodically for serum B12 and if it is found to be normal, because the requirement of B12 is seen only in about 30 to 40% of the people. So in about 60% of the people, it may be unnecessary. So if you have the option to get it tested, then we may not have to give up. But if the patient does not have the option or is going away, it's better to put the patient on B12 at least for 2 years. Thereafter, it can be checked. Iron and calcium may be required for a number of patients, especially if they are found to have in the preoperative setting. And you will have to specifically tell them the medications for diabetes and hypertension need to be titrated, which they can check with their own doctors nearby. It is of course necessary that they should come to you back for periodic review. Each center has its own protocol, but it is necessary for these patients to come because they need to be checked for nutritional deficiencies, and dietary advice may have to be given periodically. The complications of sleeve gastrectomy are well known. The most dreaded complication is a leak. The leak usually occurs at the top G junction, but occasionally it can happen elsewhere also. So the reason for this area leak is, number one, this is a high pressure system, because you have a sphincter here, you have a sphincter here, and in between the fluid collects. Number two, if there is an obstruction here, if you make it narrow, if it is twisted, then the pressure is transmitted more here. Three, vascularly, this area is the watershed zone. You have the esophagus, you have the stomach here, all the vessels have been divided here. So one of the reasons why you need to have it is you have a dog ear here, so a little extra which you can oversee. So to prevent a leak is very important. Stretching of the pouch is one of the reasons for failure of sleeve gastrectomy. This happens when you have left too much of fundus. Intra-abdominal blood bleeding or blood clots may occur because of undetected bleeding at the time of surgery, or because of the anticoagulants which are used at times. And you can rarely have internal bleeding. So when there is a bleeding, you say you have to do an endoscopy to confirm. Or most of these patients who have internal bleeding as well as intra-abdominal bleeding can be managed conservatively. Stricture is a major problem when you have made a tube which is too narrow and there is a waist where it is twisting. So, which usually does not respond to conservative management, at times may need surgery. So, you may have to revise it into some other procedure. Nutritional deficiencies are not very common in sleeve gastrectomy because there is no malabsorption. But if the patient is not taking a very healthy food or is prone for nutritional deficiency even pre-op, so they need to be managed. So, managing nutritional deficiency in sleeve is not a major problem. So as a whole, sleeve gives excellent weight reduction with reduced risk of nutritional problems. The risk of vomiting and reflux is little high in these patients because it is a high pressure zone. The loss of excess weight is almost similar to the conventional RYGB, but it is inferior to the single anastomosis or one anastomosis gastric bypass. And obviously it is inferior to other malabsorptive procedures when it comes to weight reduction. There is a risk of weight regain in almost all bariatric procedures. In sleeve gastrectomy, it is about 10 to 15% after 5 years. The primary failure, as I mentioned earlier, is due to inadequate resection of the fundus. If you leave behind fundus, that will become bigger. Secondary failure may be due to the retained fundus or due to improper diet. If the patient continues to have high calorie diet, especially liquid diet, there is no restriction imposed by the procedure. So the whole thing will be absorbed. So these patients can have inadequate weight loss or even gain. Patient's etiquette of eating needs to be emphasized. The moment the patient feels full, he should stop eating. If they stuff beyond the required levels, if they do not vomit, for a period of time, the pouch will dilate. So one of the methods by which you can prevent pouch dilatation is doing a banded sleeve, which many people are doing. Hiatus hernia or GERD is Achilles heel of sleeve gastrectomy. If you know it before, best is to opt for RYGP, which is the standard of care. There are other people who, when they detect hiatus hernia at the time of surgery, they do a hiatal dissection, mobilize the Eusen brachus like you do for any fundoplication repair. There is also an option of retaining fundus, use it as a fundoplication, and the rest of the stomach below can be resected as a sleeve gastrectomy. Rather, if there are any questions, I'll answer. I've not gone into the details of management of complications because it's a big topic by itself. But maybe I should mention about leaks. Leaks in this patient should be suspected the moment the patient is not looking well. A sleeve gastrectomy patient should look well same evening and next morning. If he is not looking well, you must suspect possibility of a leak or intra-abdominal bleeding. So it's very easy to exclude intra-abdominal bleeding because there will be a drop in hemoglobin. If there is no drop in hemoglobin and the pulse rate is high, it is very difficult to look for peritonitic signs in these patients. So it is necessary for you to suspect. And the only way you can diagnose is doing a CT with oral contrast. So it will show whether there is a leak, and if there is a leak, where is the leak, extent of leak, and whether there is a collection, etc. So the management of leak is a major issue by itself, but if it is detected in the first few days, probably it is better to go in, do a wash, drain properly, maybe you can attempt a repair, attempt to put a patch, and keep feeding jejunostomy, and later if required you can also put a intragastric stent. All other immediate complications are not very difficult to manage. Vomiting is very common, so you need to tell the patient that they and their stomach will need to be learning how to eat, how much to eat, how to improve for a period of time. My policy is to start them on 30 to 40 milliliter per hour the first post-op day, raise it to 60 to 70 ml per hour, then go on to 100 milliliter on the third day. So I tell them to be on liquids for 2 weeks, It also gives them time to get adjusted to how little their stomach can take. And eating is not a major problem if they go through these steps slowly, because they come to know. Somebody who's used to eating, let's say, 4 dosas in the morning cannot eat even 1 dosa. So obviously, if he's going to eat, he's going to vomit. If he doesn't vomit, he's going to dilate the pouch. So I tell them strictly that he is not going to eat any solids for 6 weeks.
Brilliant lecture as usual, Bhaskaran. The floor is open for anyone who want to ask questions. First of all, you put your camera on and raise your hand so that I'll unmute you so you can have your questions. And meantime, Bhaskaran, I'll start in the reverse direction. First of all, what is a tight sleeve by definition? Tight sleeve.
Yeah, if you place your stapler very close to the bougie, if you use a 32 bougie and place it very close, then it becomes a tight sleeve. So it is almost pencil thin. Only a...
Do you do tight sleeve purposely in any patient?
I used to do tight sleeves earlier. Now I'm not doing a very tight sleeve, because in any case, I'm using that bougie, which is about 37, 38 size. And the evidence shows there is no significant difference in the weight loss when you do it between 32 to 40 bougies. So it doesn't seem to be a major factor. Similarly, it doesn't seem to be a major factor how much of the antrum you leave behind. Though there are some groups, especially South American groups, they say you must excise antrum also. That is one of the reasons. See, antrum is one place where it can bulge. Fundus is another place where it can bulge. So eventually, over a period of time, these people can lead to. So my policy is to resect as much of the antrum as well.
Now, two things, Bhaskaran. In some patients, the weight loss is very drastic, and in some patients it's not. And as a bariatric surgeons, we can't predict which one is which. Do you predict?
No, it's very difficult, but you can have an idea if you put the patient on a very low calorie diet preoperatively and they reduce weight, 3 kilos, 5 kilos, 7 kilos. One of my patients reduced 18 kilos also. So that means these are the people who are exceedingly compliant. They will listen to your advice.
Okay.
And if somebody doesn't lose even 1 kilo, that means these are people who are not going to be strict about their diet even after.
So that does not have anything with the technique of a tight sleeve or a small antrum of the loss of weight subsequently.
Very difficult. You can control few things, but you can't control what the patient eats. That is one major problem. And I remember one patient who lost weight from 110 kgs to 79 kgs and stayed put there. I asked her, she was very upset that her weight has not come down. When I asked her, she said she started eating ice cream because for 7 years she was not touching ice cream. Now she is able to eat ice cream, and every day she has been eating ice cream.
Okay.
So these are the issues we'll have to go into, which the patient does not come up with.
Now we have few patients who become skin and bones and they start crying, "Doctor, do something so that they can improve my weight." Do you have patients like that, and what is your solution?
Come to less than their optimal weight so far. What happens is somebody who is say 140 kilos comes to about 80 kgs. Everybody in the family thinks he is ill. First thing we want to know is whether he has got cancer or tuberculosis.
Okay.
I remember one patient's father came to me asking that his son eats so little and he is upset. So he wanted me to reverse the procedure. I said no. So the patient is doing well. So it's a question of mindset. I am going to see a patient after his sleep who has lost weight to a level below his permissible level. There is always about 10% to 20% above the permissible level.
Okay. I see that you don't use a drain.
I use drain mostly when there is ooze. One of the reasons is I put the patients on anticoagulants from pre-op.
Okay.
So some oozing is there always.
Right.
And it also is useful because you can always pull it out after a day or two, and I don't send them one before second post-op in any case. So I'm rather comfortable keeping a drain. Sometimes you can have a serous fluid coming up for quite some time, but then you take it out by third day.
You don't use a Ryle's tube though post-op?
No, no Ryle's tube.
Right.
Ryle's tube is only first to empty. I divided a Ryle's tube once when the anesthetist has not removed it.
Well, same with me. What happened later on?
I opened the suture, sutured it.
How did you open the laparoscopically?
Yeah. At the time only.
Oh, I mean, while pulling the rail sieve, it is not coming out, right?
No. When you're firing the staple, I found it a little difficult.
Okay. Oh, okay. Then what do you do?
So I fired it. Then I realized probably something is there. I asked them, is the rail sieve there? The person said, is there. I said, remove it. You couldn't remove it.
Then?
So I opened it. Made a hole.
Laparoscopically.
I cut for the suture line. Asked the anesthetist to remove it. Then I sutured it.
See, I had one patient in whom the rail sieve got stuck. And actually, day one, we didn't bother. Day two, when my reser was pulling out, it wasn't coming. Then I said, just give it a tug. She gave it a tug and it came up. Oh. I mean, no. It wasn't coming. Then what we did, went endoscopically and cut the tube very close to the whatever. Now a bit of the tube is still in the suture line and that patient has lost considerable weight. And whenever he comes to see me, sir, you see that I'm the rail sieve patient. And that's very much in position. Yeah, I mean, that's a very major thing. From that time onwards, our anesthetists are very worried about the rail sieve. You know, every time we'll keep checking on that. Secondly, you use methylene blue, right?
Yeah.
Isn't it messy?
It is a little messy, but our people have got used to it and immediately aspirate. One advantage of a methylene blue is that you don't have to change the position. If you want to use saline, you've got to put the position head low. Then it's there. So both options I have.
No, but have you any time seen a leak with methylene blue?
No, I've not seen.
Then why should you do it?
See, it gives me the satisfaction, number one. It also gives me the size of the pouch.
Okay.
So generally my pouches are about 70 milliliter capacity.
No, you're not going to change anything, whatever be the size of the pouch now.
No, it's not going to change, but it gives me the satisfaction the pouch is really small.
Okay, it's a matter of satisfaction because I don't use any method for checking.
Yeah, but also since there is a drain and if there is going to be a leak, I'll see methylene blue. Methylene blue will stay for some time and stay in the tissue. So if there is a leak, you'll know where the leak is even without anything else. I mean, it is more out of, let's say, habit. Maybe I'll discontinue. Sometimes I use air, which is a much simpler way. I use air and I do gastric bypass and all others because where the risk of leak is much less.
Right. Anybody wants to ask a question, please switch on your camera and...
Sir, this is Ilango here.
Ilango, we can't see you though.
I don't know how to correct that, sir.
No, you switch your camera on. At the left bottom.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Oh, yeah. So, I didn't know you were Zoom savvy. No, you should come on Zoom now.
Bhaskar, sir, how do you ensure that the fundus is completely resected?
Yeah, that is what. See, I wanted to show a video, but it is time consuming. So you got to take it off slowly, deliberately, and make sure that the active blade is not touching the stomach. So you'll have to lift it off totally, and you will see the whole left crest fully. So entire left crest should be visible, and maybe the beginning of the right crest alone. Yeah.
Okay. All right, sir.
Most important. Hey.
Ilango, don't try doing bariatric. That is not your area.
No. I just got interested in the talk. That's why I came.
No, just joking.
I didn't get disturbed, so I actually came down to the car to listen very quietly.
Okay. Anybody else wants to come on? Anybody else want to ask a question? Harsha, Vishranka, anyone? Then have questions, then we'll close the session. Thanks, Bhaskar. Thank you so much.
I hope you recorded because I couldn't record. It said...
You cannot. I only... Because today I'm the admin and you're not the host. I'm the host. I'm recording. I have the recording. Not an issue. Okay. Tomorrow we'll be coming with the Ruvai bypass.
Yeah,
thank you so much. We'll see you again at 10 o'clock tomorrow, Bhaskar.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Thanks.